Good morning, everyone, and thank you for starting your day with lawyers. We appreciate it at the tech conference very much. My name is Susan Cassidy. I am a partner at Covington and Burling. I spend a lot of my time doing cybersecurity and government contracts. So most of my focus is on incidents, breaches, and counseling relating to government data that may be being protected by my client base. I'm going to ask each of my panelists to introduce themselves, starting with Chris.
Great. Thank you. I'm Chris Hale. I'm Executive Director and Associate General Counsel for Cybersecurity at Raytheon Technologies, where I lead the corporate legal team that advises on cybersecurity matters.
I'm Jim Sfekas. I'm Assistant General Counsel at Microsoft. I'm responsible for the Microsoft 365 security compliance and management services, and then our incident response for those services as well.
And I'm Maddie Neustadt. I'm at NetApp, where I'm the Director of Legal for Privacy, Cybersecurity, and Data Governance.
Okay, so why don't we talk a little bit about what we're going to speak to you about today, and obviously we welcome questions from anyone in the audience, and I see there's mics set up for folks to ask. Just go up there and we'll try and answer as we can. This is Victim and Vectors Mitigating Legal Risks of Supply Chain Attacks. We're going to discuss the legal strategies associated with supply chain cybersecurity attacks, including the laws and regulations that may govern this area and some of the best practices for responding to and mitigating those risks. So the threat landscape, I'm sure we don't have to spend a whole lot of time on this, but let's just talk about what we're going to be focusing on. Supply chain or third-party risks against suppliers of an organization allow indirect access to high-value organizations that often are more difficult to target directly. Large organizations are more likely to have more sophisticated security controls. It's a bit of a generalization, I understand, but it does make infiltration difficult. So attackers are often looking for ways through the suppliers to these organizations, and these attacks involve usually high degree of planning, sophistication. They can obviously have a devastating impact on the organizations. So two types of supply chain attacks we're going to focus on today. One type occurs when cyber criminals successfully infiltrate large companies by targeting vendors that are integrated into a company's information systems. Think managed service providers, hardware and software vendors, and technology and business partners, many of which are connected into various applications and databases. If an attacker can infiltrate a partner organization, it then has an entry point to the more attractive large organization. Think Okta and Kaseya as examples. Second type of supply chain attack is one that seeks to exploit the trust between the legitimate organizations used in normal business operations. These types of attacks seek to gain unauthorized access to a target organization by implanting backdoors into products. It's typically software is what we've been seeing. Those are then used by the target organization, which allow the attacker to infiltrate. Think again, SolarWinds and NotPetya. So complicating all of these risks, obviously, is the larger surface area we're seeing for both types of attacks. Larger and more complex supply chains, trends such as remote work, increased connected device, greater prevalence of bring your own device, all of these expand the attack surface. So not only are there more avenues of attack, but the sophistication of the attackers and the types of attacks are also increasing. What we also are seeing, though, is that the government and the commercial sectors are responding to these type of attacks. So let's talk a little bit about that. And I think we'll start with Chris on the government response.
Great, thanks, Susan. So yeah, as a result of a lot of these supply chain attacks you've seen, I mean, it's not surprising, we've seen a lot of responses from governments around the world. I mean, this ranges from things like increased cyber threat intelligence sharing, like we see that a lot in the States with DHS's CISA, Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, like for example, with their Shields Up campaign after Log4j. You see increasing laws and regulations around supply chain exclusion, where the government has a right to tell private sector to not use certain, let's say, information and communications technology, goods and services from, let's say, that have associated with some kind of a nation state that isn't trusted. You also see data localization in some places. But here, what we want to focus on are the laws and regulations that really incentivize or mandate companies and owners and operators of critical infrastructure to increase the resilience of their cybersecurity and to report incidents. So, and as Susan mentioned, SolarWinds, and after the SolarWinds attack really came to light in late 2020, we really did see a flurry of activity in the U.S. government. First was the Biden executive order of May 2021. That was one of the most far-reaching cybersecurity executive orders in history in the United States. And it did a few things. I mean, a lot of it was really aimed internally at the executive branch, because that's the authority that the executive orders have. They were focused on things like having other agencies modernize their cybersecurity, go to a zero trust architecture, move to a secure cloud. But not surprisingly, a lot of it was also aimed at the government supply chain, which are, of course, companies and other owners and operators of critical infrastructure as well. In some cases, and so the executive order actions were aimed at getting DHS and working with OMB to come up with more contractual clauses that would increase and mandate the increase of information sharing from IT and OT providers to basically share incident information, right? Kind of the SolarWinds type issue, right? Like, you know, they want to increase that kind of information sharing.
Just to highlight one, or to elaborate on that one,
yeah.
You know, prior to the executive order, agencies weren't even willing to let a common service provider share information about breaches with CISA in any form. So, the EO represented a real sea change on government collaboration there.
Yeah, no, for sure. And then also a really interesting part of the EO, I think, is Section 4. And that's what was really aimed at securing software supply chain. That's a really hard issue, right? How can an executive order result in more secure software across the world, right? Or at least across the United States? And the answer is, it's like it can't directly, but certainly the way that the executive order did it is that they mandated that there would be a rule, a contract clause eventually that would mandate a secure software standards on sellers of software to the government. And they asked NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, to come up with those standards. And there's been a whole host of work by NIST. They've hosted a bunch of workshops and they've come out with all kinds of documentation around secure software development frameworks, around creating a minimum standards for testing of software code, to looking at SBOMs, the software bills of materials, lots of work. And the idea there will be that those standards will be put into a contract clause, which will be required by sellers to the US government. And you can imagine the influence that's going to have, right? Because I mean, if you're creating software for the government using these standards, what are you going to sell, like a different version of the software to non-U.S. government buyers that's less secure? You know, probably not. And it's probably a matter of time before you see commercial buyers asking for the same standards from commercial sellers, because they're out there. So that'll be an interesting development. And then finally,
and Chris, we're already seeing some of
that
too in the private sector. And I think there's another slide later about how the standard of care is evolving, even for private companies, because
right.
where Jim said, you know, the government agencies were previously forbidden from co-sharing information from common suppliers, how many times does that happen in private industry because you've got a non-disclosure agreement or a non-disclosure clause in your contract, so that if somebody discloses a security incident to you, you're prohibited by contract from then sending that on. So it reaches beyond the government as well, and the work that NIST is doing will probably get adopted in other forms as well.
Right. No, I think it's a good point. And yeah. One other point, too, that people don't often think about is that the EO also mandated CISA to create an incident response plan for the federal civilian executive branch agencies, and also a vulnerability response plan. Mm-hmm. Right. So now you've got that document out there. So a lot of times you go to cyber conferences and they say, oh, need to have a cyber response plan. You need to practice it. Well, what about your vulnerability response plan, right? That now there's a document out there that is for use by private sector if they would like to, although it's not mandated. About 10 months after that EO came out, Congress also had its response to SolarWinds, and that was the Critical Infrastructure Reporting Act, and that was passed in March. And just bottom line is that just requires it mandates DHS, CISA, to come up with a rule. They have 2 years to create a proposed rule, and a year and a half after that to finalize the rule, incorporating comments. And at a bottom line, it's going to require critical infrastructure entities to report cyber incidents to the U.S. government. They need to do that within 72 hours. And they also need to report ransomware payments within 24 hours. And so a lot of questions around how are we defining like which entities have to report, the triggers, right? Those are to come. But one of the triggers is certainly supply chain compromise or an attack on your managed service provider, cloud service providers. So that's coming, and that's a direct response to SolarWinds. And then we also see a number of agencies also getting into the mix. The SEC, after SolarWinds, sent out letters to a number of companies asking them how they were impacted by SolarWinds. Kind of shows that they're getting more involved in the mix. The SEC just came out with a proposed rule that would mandate enhanced disclosure of cybersecurity incidents and risk management as well. So that rule, if it gets finalized, will require companies to report material incidents within 4 business days. And these are, mind you, public reports, right? These are public reports that go out to investors. And it also requires talking about your risk management plans as well. The FTC has gotten involved as well. After Log4j, the Federal Trade Commission put out a note saying folks need to respond to known vulnerabilities. Otherwise, these could be actionable under FTC Act as well. And then finally, we can't forget all the international legislation. We don't have time to go into it here, obviously. But suffice it to say that some key ones are in the EU and China. There's of course many others, but EU takes an even more comprehensive approach than the United States. They don't just require critical infrastructure to report incidents. They also mandate that they meet adequate security and that there's enhanced supervision and enforcement by the government.
Next version of the EU NIS directive, right, is expanding the scope of what's considered critical infrastructure to include certain supply chains within the critical infrastructure. So it's beginning to hit more and more players in the area, even if they didn't traditionally think they were a critical infrastructure provider. And of course, the Chinese PIPL, mm-hmm, critical infrastructure could change at the whim of the government as soon as the government tells you your critical infrastructure or your critical infrastructure.
One comment on the U.S. government's response as well is it's been really interesting to see how Chris mentioned the SEC and the FTC both starting to take action. It's interesting to see the ways that they're using their inherent authority or their generalized authority to start zeroing in on cybersecurity issues. The SEC, obviously they are promulgating these new rules. But even in the absence of those rules, they're already using, and SolarWinds is a great example, but not the only example, they're already using their general regulatory power over public companies to say, well, this breach is material. It must be material. It has an impact on your stock. Therefore, did you appropriately disclose this material information at the right time? And relatedly, are your own insiders, whether you're executives or your incident response people, taking advantage of that insider knowledge during the period after prior to disclosure? And both of those things don't require new regulation, are just an expanded choice to expand their exercise of the power of their power.
And I think they're taking a page from the playbook on the FTC and enforcing privacy in many of that ways,
right,
because the FTC is taking that approach for privacy regulation in that it can become an unfair deceptive trade practice if your privacy policy notice states you do one thing and then you don't do it. They can use that same regulatory authority for security oversights if you make assertions in your marketing or in your notices that you take reasonable security or that you implement security practices. The FTC will now look at that as unfair or potentially unfair trade practices if they find that you aren't actually doing that. And we may find too that the pendulum is going to swing, because right now, whether or not something's material, you almost are judging in hindsight, which, let's face it, in hindsight, it always looks more material than it may have been when the information was first coming in. So is there going to be a requirement to over-disclose, and then what's going to be that implication from a legal point of view? If you over-disclose and you're wrong, are you going to have any responsibility or liability associated with over-disclosing? Under-disclosing, obviously, that comes with regulatory risk, but over-disclosing poses its own set of risks.
One of the other things that we're seeing is that as you get all these additional disclosure obligations, they set off a cascading issue for you, because you have Think something simple, your insurance. If you've had to make a disclosure that is not privileged to someone, you may have just triggered all your insurance disclosure. So it's very important in what we have seen with clients, understanding and incorporating all of these requirements into your cyber incident response plan so that you're not forgetting something and you're not giving up something that you might otherwise have be entitled to. I didn't mean to interrupt.
Oh, no, the incident responders, if there are any, I know there's at least a few in the room, know the pain that comes from early disclosure. You know, where are we left if the SEC or other regulatory agencies are forcing extremely early disclosure at a time when you are so early in incident response that you actually put yourself at greater risk by those disclosures? That's not the intent of the SEC or these other agencies, but there's a real risk that the sort of dull knife of some of these regulations and these agency actions will put us actually at greater security risk if we start having to talk about incidents at a time when we haven't fully
resolved or mitigated
right,
the issue.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I was going to make a more generalized point for the lawyers in the audience. This is, I think, going to be a running theme throughout. Is this is an area where we don't get the luxury of saying, "Oh, that's a business issue," and so as lawyers, it's not really our problem. You know, what Maddie was getting at just a moment ago is about, you know, unfair trade practices, leading to regulatory action. But unfair trade practices stems from a business decision. So as lawyers, we're going to be responsible for thinking about what are those business implications, because at a certain point, the business implications become so significant that they cross over into legal risk.
Yeah. So we've talked about the problems
that right.
the government is imposing. Maybe we can talk a little bit about what is the commercial market doing in the response. I think, Maddie, you were going to start with this one?
Yeah, and for this one, I think the biggest thing that we are seeing here, and what it really comes down to as lawyers, we understand the concept of a standard of care. What is the standard of care in this area? And that is very quickly evolving, not only with the regulatory landscape and the case law and the regulatory holdings that are coming through, but with new standards, with new controls, with new NIST level standards, the evolution of ISO controls, the evolution of SOC 2 controls, expectations in the marketplace based on the nature of the data that you are dealing with, in terms of what standard will you hold yourself to in caring for and protecting that data. And so you get a lot of higher expectations, certainly higher around the world than they were, say, 5 years ago. But then certain regulatory industries or certain, what's the phrase I'm looking for? Certain market segments, basically your financial services, your healthcare services, your higher value data companies, they're gonna have a different level of standard of care. And this is oddly reflected in laws, and there's, I think, a big difference between our European laws and our United States laws in terms of protecting data. There's a lot of times where the laws are written and they want to politically bring up new players. They want to encourage small business growth. So there's exceptions for compliance for small companies. And they just say, oh, well, the big companies, they need to do this. But the small companies, especially in a supply chain now, are just as risky to the data. And so you have to look at, what is the standard of care? Is the standard of care based on the size of the business, or is the standard of care based on the risk associated with the data types that are coming through? And I think global political leaders are currently really struggling with that, because everybody's trying to build up their own economies around the next level of digital economy, an economy in the metaverse. Everybody wants their technology sector to flourish, but at the same time, you then have the United States taking a very financial view of data and data protection. It's, you want to put the highest level of protection on the most financially valuable data, and Europe saying, well, no, data has to do with civil rights, human rights. We need the ability to be secure in the metaverse. So it's about, you know, digital fundamental human rights and not about financial capabilities. And we're getting some competing regimes then between the US sector and the EU sector. And for a multinational company like my employer, NetApp, to harmonize those two through a standard standard operational set of care for data governance or data security becomes very difficult because you're trying to make the whole world happy.
I think, and you know, even in the absence of clear regulation and clear legal guidance, we are definitely seeing the some of our more sophisticated customers are starting to push on their own perception of what do they need from their own supply chain to manage their risk. And so on the one hand, a push to service providers to provide expertise that they may have trouble getting on their own, but absolutely, all of those companies are pressing for earlier, quicker reporting of service provider incidents, not explicitly because they're required by law, but just because I think what they're seeing is, as much as they would love to rely on and do want to rely on the service providers, the cloud, and so on to provide greater security for them, they're sort of recognizing that using the cloud doesn't eliminate their own responsibility for their own security. At the end of the day, it is the end customer that is responsible for understanding the state of their own security. And so they're pressing those service providers, give me that 24, 48 hour notice, even though even GDPR gives longer than that. But
Funny though, because we also see, especially as lawyers negotiate contracts, you see this 24 hour notice, 72 hour notice, four business right. day reporting, five business day reporting. We haven't yet evolved past the point where we think security has to do with incident notification. Mm-hmm. Like when you get that, if you're running a multi-million dollar company and you find out something like Kaseya has hit your supply chain and they're like, you get a notice and all it says is, this is your notice that to tell you 18 hours ago, we recognized a major vulnerability flaw in our entire infrastructure that impacts you. Thank you, have a nice day, we value your security. What are you going to do with that? Like, do you shut down your business? Do you log out of everything? Do you hit the big off switch? And I think there's still a lot of work to do, and especially that we as lawyers can do in educating our clients to say, okay, that's for after something has gone terribly wrong. What do we want to do to prevent something from going terribly wrong? Do we want to ensure that specific security standards, do we want to ensure that secure development lifecycle is put in place? Do we want to require a specific control set, the NIST 800-171, the NIST 853, the ISO 27001? Like, will one of those control sets give us more comfort that the company is operating to a certain level of baseline security, even though compliance is not security? It at least provides you some evidence that people are thinking about it. But if all you're asking for is like, well, just give me shorter and shorter notice, give me 1 hour notice when something goes wrong. Well, what are you gonna do with that?
Well, I think one of the issues, and I think Chris and I have talked about this in the past, is that you have to be careful. How much information do I want from my suppliers? Because once you have it, you're now responsible for it. So if you know something, so that has been something I think we'll talk about in the mitigation yep. side. Greatest scrutiny of suppliers, but be careful what information you have in your system, because at that point you're responsible for it. So there is a weighing of the risks about having an appropriate knowledge of your suppliers versus having maybe knowing too much. Yeah. But we'll talk about that in the mitigation, I think.
Yeah.
And I think that's in mitigation too, but I know we have in here like increased scrutiny of suppliers. Mm-hmm. Again, there's knowing too much about your suppliers. Who sends out a supplier questionnaire yeah. for security practices? Yeah. Who puts them on an online form so people just have to check a box, yes or no? Okay, thank you. Those questionnaires are floating around everywhere. We regularly get them in. They're 800-900 questions. They're typically sent to a sales or sales ops team. They're trying to give the most, and at least for my company, we have a portfolio, a suite of products and services. That's about 125 different services and products. And we operate in a hybrid cloud and an on-premise environment. So the answers to every single one of those questions is probably, in my favorite lawyer voice, it depends. And mine's a small company. Jim here, your SKU list is thousands. So how do you answer a single vendor questionnaire truthfully and with enough information to be informative to a company doing diligence on cybersecurity supply chain when you have hundreds or thousands of products or services in your portfolio? For each one could be slightly different answer for those questions. How much faith
you
got to
be staffed too to be able to read those, and also and also to make smart decisions based on those. I mean, I won't ask for a show of hands, but who has actually stopped a contract with a supplier based on those responses, right?
Yeah.
You know, crickets oftentimes, right? So I mean, you have to, if you're going to get that data, you need to actually review it and have a reasonable, like, you know, decision-making process as a result.
And that goes to what Susan said. Yeah. If you're not going to act on the data, do you really want to have it in-house so that you have imputed knowledge, if nothing else, of things that could be very bad?
Especially the more detailed questionnaires.
Yeah.
Especially with regulators.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I think we have some, should we go to the next slide?
Okay, yeah. So legal implications. Why don't we talk a little bit about, I think you had started to introduce this, Maddie, with the standard of care, but why don't we talk a little bit about this?
Yeah, and this is your basic negligence standard of care. What is the standard? Did you meet the standard? And was harm done? And that's kind of the way that legal liability is currently being approached in cybersecurity. Less so in privacy, but of course you can't do privacy without security. Security is fundamental to meeting privacy obligations. So what is that standard of care? And is it based on the size of your company? Is it based on the nature of the data with which you work? Is it based on some third factor? How are you setting the standard of care for your clients and advising them on what the standard is that they need to take when protecting the data? Some of it you get easy answers if you're a government contractor and you have the DFARS built into your contract or the new cybersecurity executive order built into it. You're being told that's already done through regulation, that here is your standard of care, it's been laid out for you. But what if you're just a commercial company and you are going to be creating the newest cloud-based Angry Dogs game to be marketed across the world? What standard do you need to hold your data to? Are you marketing to children? Do you have additional obligations under child online privacy protection? Do you have additional obligations to report to authorities? What type of data do you have, and what's the standard associated with the data? And as a lawyer, I tend to focus on the classification and the nature of the data rather than the size of business you are. The number of companies I've worked with that have talked to me and they're like, oh, well, we're in startup mode. Like, we don't really pay attention to that because we're too busy being in startup mode. We have to be agile. Where, you know, one, as a lawyer, you can still remind people that agile still is a system. It is not a synonym for ad hoc. So you have to figure out what is the standard of care that applies across your agile development platform in your startup mode. And if the client's going to decide, hey, startup mode means we don't pay attention to the law until we reach Series C financing. I'm like, all right, we'll make sure Series C has enough money to bring in the lawyers and clean up this mess. So you have to look at it that way. If you start and build security in from the very beginning, even in startup mode, it's going to be a lot easier to get to your Series B, your Series C, your IPO. Otherwise, you're going to have a lot of cleanup to do. But even at a large company in-house, the same thing. If you're going to buy a target company, you're going to acquire a new entity, and they've been in startup mode the whole time, you know, what's the diligence level you need to put on the security work that they've done pre-acquisition? Are you going to have to you know, what type of data are they dealing with? How are they securing that data? How are they using it across the supply chain? What third parties are they using for the operation of their business? What third party code do they have in their products and services? What open source code do they have in their products and services where you may not even know who the third parties are that added to it? Have they kept their open source disclosures up to date so that you can track back through attribution the vendors who have put code into their products and services? You know, and once you realize what level of risk you're sitting on in the data with an acquisition target, You know, chances are if you're me, you're told, well, we're just going to build it into the price and fix it after, fix it as part of the integration time period. Well, do you need to quarantine that stuff before you fix it? How high of a risk is it? So what do you need to do to address that risk in a merger and acquisition action? So
what about the issue? I'd be curious from the panel. I mean, there is no standard of care. When I talk to clients about it, I can't give them one standard of care. I mean, if you run
across, hindsight right now. It really is truly hindsight. You just have to look at where other people have failed and hope you don't make the same mistakes they did.
I'd also say this is one of those, you know, what I was sort of alluding to earlier of the blurry line between business risk and legal risk. You know, what is the real risk out of, you know, where does standard of care become relevant when you get sued? Who's gonna sue? The people that are mad at you. And that's where things like reputational harm and the impact on business opportunities come into play, and why they are more than purely business issues. Because, you know, every one of these, whether it's a security breach, it's a data breach, you know, impacts your perception in the broader marketplace. It impacts your perception by your own customers, and, you know, happy customers don't sue their vendors. It's the ones that are mad. And you know,
and the ones that get really mad are the ones that have completely adopted your technology and have put it into their product. And now you've not only hurt yourself, you've hurt their brand.
Your most trusted, exactly. Yeah. Your very best customers are the ones that are going to be most mad. And that's, you know, that's when you know, the standard of care becomes, how mad did you make me? Go ahead.
No, I think about it as, you know, like going back to the whole reasonable man or woman thought, right? Like, what would a reasonable person do in a similarly situated situation, right? And I think of it as, it's not, I mean, you can think about it and slice and dice it, and it can get complicated, but in the end, what's the right thing to do, right? I mean, we all know, for example, as I talk to many of my colleagues, where a lot of times this goes sideways is where one of your customers feels like you informed them late, right? Really basic, right? If they feel like you informed them late and they look back at it, they're going to be mad. Right, and the same thing with the regulator as well. So right now you've got that, and also, what are basic, you know, security safeguards? Well, what are basic processes you should be having with your suppliers? These are changing, right? We just mentioned a little while ago. Now you have a vulnerability response process is now becoming more and more standard, right? Maybe a year ago nobody would have expected that, or 2 years ago. Now the next log4j, people are going to be like, what was your vulnerability response plan, right? Did you act appropriately and with due speed? So this is a changing standard.
And we're already seeing higher and higher demands for contract terms relating to vulnerability disclosures, vulnerability remediation. And that gets to be a real challenge, because a lot of people who work here, you can mitigate vulnerabilities in different ways. And depending on how strict your customer may be, there are some areas of the world that they are very prescriptive in what they want to see in a contract. Hello, Germany. But the reality of vulnerability remediation is you don't fully patch every single vulnerability, because there could be a less intrusive way to address the risk than to spend weeks, months, years trying to develop the perfect patch for, you know, a CVSS with a score of 0.2. You're just not going to do it.
I mean, one of the things that I do with clients when they're struggling with, there's a lot of competing risks, right? There's a lot of competing risks. You have to make a decision. I ask them to go to the end of the line saying, 2 months from now, when you have to explain this to somebody, what's your story going to be? And are you comfortable that story 2 months from now, what you do now is going to be right? Because it really is. There's no, you can't give them guidance on explicit requirements other than the government contractor.
Yeah.
It's national security. I can tell you what to do. But the commercial market, it's not so easy. So a lot of it is really it's your reputational harm or something. Bad things happen to good companies, but if you react reasonably and you value your clients and you give them the information they need when they need it, and you think about what that story is going to look like 3 months from now, usually my clients come out okay.
And there's reasonable under the law, and there's commercially reasonable.
Yes.
And you want to hit that commercially reasonable. And that's where you get, you know, you don't spend $1 billion fixing a CVSS with a score of 0.2. It's not commercially reasonable to put that much effort into it. But when you get into a higher CVSS, something like log4j, that you say, okay, what is the commercially reasonable amount of time, money, and effort to spend on this? Because if you go in 2 months from now and your response is, how come you didn't do X, it's really hard advice to go to your executive, say, okay, why didn't we do this? 2 months from now, if we say, why don't we do this? If your answer was, ooh, it was really hard, nobody is going to accept that. There's got to be something more measured out. You've got to at least put the effort into the analysis to figure out what the business risk is, what is the cost of mitigating that business risk, and how do you find that balance? And then, as a lawyer, document the living heck out of it.
Yeah, I mean, it's the I think the modern tech supply chain relies on trust every step of the way, and so building on Maddie's point that it's not really always about the CVSS score, it's about the bigger impact on, and you can frame it in a million different ways. At Microsoft, we absolutely talk about it in terms of trust, and I do like, and I think Chris mentioned this earlier, sometimes the right answer, the right next step as a lawyer is not to talk about the legal risk, it's to ask the clients, what is the right thing to do here? Let's talk about what is the right thing to do, and then we can start to dig in on the details.
And an acceptable level of risk. I mean, we all take a risk. We took a risk coming here in hopefully the tail end of a global pandemic, but we viewed it as a reasonable risk because we had taken mitigative steps. We'd been vaccinated. We've sanitized our hands mm-hmm. until the skin's coming off. We're ready to get back into society. We know it's a reasonable risk to be back here. So when you're looking at mitigation strategies, how are you advising your clients how do we reasonably take a risk without destroying trust?
Sounds like a segue.
We're going to move to mitigation. One thing I'm interested in is one of the struggles I also see with clients is who's making that decision. Mm-hmm. That is often so interested in thoughts on that. So mitigation, I'm going to show you two slides. And Jim's going to start the lead here. We thought about mitigation. We spent a lot of time talking about this because this is really probably where the rubber hits the road. And we came up with a number of buckets. But here's some of the mitigation areas. And Jim will talk about how we've divided them up.
Just
let me go back to the first slide. There you go.
It's so much. There's so many different possibilities in front of you. And as we were talking about how to talk about this in this panel, we started to realize that there's a way to categorize some of these mitigations and to provide a framework to think about what is the value you're getting from them. And we roughly chop that up into prevent, detect, respond, and recover. Prevent what are the mitigations that we're doing in advance to prevent or assess ahead our supply chain risk. Detect, what can we do to detect the a supply chain compromise or risk in the moment as it's occurring? Respond, even more so. What do we do once having detected it? What do we do to come back from or to respond to like address it immediately? And then recovery, how do we return ourselves to full operation after the fact? On the prevention front, know your suppliers. I feel like I cannot say that strongly enough. And this is a spot where, again, what is the difference between a legal risk and a business risk? The steps of knowing your suppliers, and remember, as you're thinking about knowing your suppliers, that may seem easy. Maybe you feel like, it's all good. I can look at all my purchase orders and I know what I've what IT has been spending money on. But don't forget about shadow IT. Don't forget about your employees who because your systems aren't adequate for them, they start using Dropbox to share files, and things like that. So
they're on a BYO device, and how many people give their phones to their kids?
Right.
And I was talking to somebody and said, my kid knows to hit the big green checkbox if the multi-factor authentication comes on while they're playing a game because I'm logging into VPN or something.
Yeah.
And my first thought was, I'm terrified now. Like my kids randomly knowing to click the green checkbox every time multi-factor comes on.
Yeah. So know who your suppliers are and know how you use them. Are you, you know, because not every supplier is created equally, and this is where we get pragmatic again, and we say, you can't afford to go into a panic when every single, you know, for every single one of your suppliers reporting a problem. You need to know which are the ones that require all hands on deck, and which are the ones that we just need to install a patch, and actually, or where we can afford to just stop using it for a month or two because the risk is too high.
And by the way, this is where some of your privacy operations could be very helpful, because you may have been required to create things like data maps for GDPR compliance. Those data maps can be used in cybersecurity supply chain risk to look at that same data. So make sure when you're knowing your supplier that you have cross-functional teams and you're involving more than just your security team or just your procurement team to figure out where your data is going back and forth.
And let me get really tactical for a second. Consider some specific classes of tools that you may want to deploy. Now this is supposed to be a lawyer panel. Why am I talking about this? But consider a CASB. That's a cloud access
security broker.
Thank you. Never can remember. Consider vulnerability management service. Why do lawyers care about that? Because both of those exist to address a set of risks to the company. Some of those risks come from the legal side of things. So as a lawyer, you have a responsibility to say, I cannot tell you, and I will not tell you to deploy a CASB. I will not tell you to deploy vulnerability management. I will, however, tell you that if you do not have those things, there is a substantial question of whether you have met the standard of care. And
now you're seeing more things come out in FTC decisions and in SEC findings and in court findings that said, hey, you didn't have vulnerability management. You didn't have a CASB installed. You didn't have DLP. And they're starting to mention these technologies in the legal decisions to kind of start forming that case law-based standard of care. So you have to, you know, have to pay attention to that stuff.
Yeah, so number one, as lawyers, as tech lawyers, we have to be tech lawyers. We have to know what's happening, and we have to know what these tools are about, because that's how we're gonna be able to give the quality advice, and we have to make sure that our clients are hearing the full scope of risks. If they then say, we are not in a stage where we can deploy CASB, where we can deploy vulnerability management, that's a choice that you know the right level of leadership can make, but they are not and should not be making that choice without the advice of their lawyers on what they're risking by not doing that. So on the prevent front, always be looking out ahead. Always be thinking about what is the scope of your vulnerability.
Okay, so why don't we turn to detect? I think, Maddie, that was something you were gonna start us with.
Well, detecting is, other than the knowing your supplier and keeping track of your asset inventories and your data processing inventories, knowing how they're interconnected, that's your best detection mechanism, whether you do it as part of your generalized business operations. Lot of ability right now to overlap that with privacy operations, because privacy has been keeping data processing inventories for a while under GDPR. So the number of times that I talk to security professionals who have not engaged with their privacy teams to learn about what systems they have in their in-house is just kind of disappointing. There's a lot of overlap there that can be used in shared knowledge, that can be used to detect risks in your supply chain by knowing how data flows throughout your supply chain. You know, we talk about, and at NetApp this gets to be a real challenge because we're transitioning from a hardware company to a cloud and services one, and people still think supply chain means the widgets coming over on chips. And supply chain now is data supply chain. Where does the data originate? How many people process the data before it gets to me? Once the data gets to me, how many pieces of code have sucked onto the back of it so that I'm processing somebody else's data? So what does the data supply chain look like? And knowing your vendors and utilizing some of the same tools that other areas of the company have put in place becomes integral. So a huge part of detection is making sure that you have cross-functional groups within your organization talking to each other, being aware of how each group not only uses tools and data, but what they can learn from each other on how to improve their own detection mechanisms for issues within the supply chain.
And in both preparing and in detection, don't ever forget about open source, because you certainly aren't going to have purchase orders around your open source, and every one of your engineers is going to be, as they do their work, thinking about, are there open source tools, are there open source frameworks and libraries I can rely on? And that's good. That makes them more efficient. That's great news. But it is still the responsibility of the consumers of that open source to make sure that you have a catalog of what you're doing. And we were just talking about this yesterday. It turns out you probably do, because if you are using open source and you are modifying that open source, you're probably tracking your use at a minimum to make sure that you're doing appropriate attribution. Thank you, Maddie. Somehow that word seems to vanish for all of us. That you're doing appropriate attribution of the components that you're using. So somewhere you probably do. If you're doing open source correctly, you probably do. So you have that opportunity to leverage that for your to protect your supply chain as well.
All right, respond. Chris, why don't you help us on what would fall in that bucket?
Sure, so in respond, I think that it's helpful to think about kind of your general supply chain response process on the one hand, and then your vendor and your vulnerability response process on the other hand, because they are somewhat different. So if it is a supplier who's informing you of an incident, that's not like a vendor or some kind of a managed service provider or a cloud service provider. I mean, it kind of helps to just think about, okay, how does the initial notification happen, right? Do you have a central email address where the incident notifications go to, or does it go to like somebody across your organization? And if it does go to a non-centralized place, is the rest of the company aware? Because I mean, I work, like a lot of us work at large companies that have various divisions. If one division finds out about it, what if the other division is impacted by the same supplier? So kind of helping to ensure that, having one central email address managed by somebody that then informs the rest of the right kind of people, the rest of the company, the points of contact, that can be helpful. And then having your response team, looking at, what's the impact of the incident? What's the technical impact of the incident? Do I have my own reporting obligations as a result of my supplier telling me? Who do I need to go tell? And having this already in practice, I think, is really helpful. And then also looking to see, is that supplier connected to my system, right? If that supplier had a ransomware incident, is there some kind of access that maybe their employees have into my system that might be a threat vector, right? And then when it comes to vulnerability response, I mean, this is where really having a practice vulnerability response plan along the lines of what I mentioned earlier is really helpful, right? I mean, hopefully, as Maddie had mentioned, you have good asset management. So if you know that there is a vulnerability in a particular piece of software, that okay, who across the enterprise can check to see if that vulnerability exists, if that application exists. Hopefully, you have tools in place that can easily respond to that. And in some cases, like with Solar or with Log4j, it can be very difficult, right? I mean, you have this vulnerability. It's in a piece of open source software. How do I go about and look to see where am I vulnerable? Well, in those cases, in that particular case, DHS CISA came out with this with actual vulnerability guidance. I mean, you go on there and they have this nice GitHub page set up, right? Where I can go look at to see what kinds of software is impacted. Well, hopefully somebody's looking at that, because if you've got like a beautiful piece of information right there, we should be looking at that as well. So,
and that's informative even in the private sector, because it's a good piece of information. Just because you're not a government contractor doesn't mean you can't use the information. You are paying their salaries with your taxes. You might as well use what they put out.
Yeah.
Well, and CISA has their catalog of vulnerable software as well as a great resource. Some might say maybe too many things are too much to keep up with, but if you're keeping an eye out on what CISA is instructing government agencies to update, which patches to apply, that can be useful for every single one of us, because those are intended to be vulnerabilities or vulnerable versions that are under active attack.
Right. Well, we've hit our limit. I think the summary coming out of this is that the standard of care is unclear. Your lawyers are valuable because they can help you make decisions before, during, and after an incident. And This is going to continue to evolve. And so just, you know, keeping an eye on it and making sure that the IT teams, the business teams, and the lawyers are all talking to each other is more likely going to end up with a good result. Thank you very much to our panelists.